Well, a very good morning to all, and welcome to MLA's First Cattle Projections webinar for 2022. Today we'll be discussing MLA's First Cattle Projections release of 2022, with the key focus being on growth in the national herd and the increasing slaughter and production numbers as the rebuild continues to mature and take shape into a two-paced form. Thanks for taking time to attend. My name is Brendan Wade and I will be your moderator for today. At MLA, I'm the Livestock Market Officer Manager looking after 30 livestock market officers that report on 70 odd sale yards nationally on a weekly basis. The team presenting today, taking you through the February release of the cattle projections, will be Mr. Steve Bignell, the Market Information Manager, and Mr. Ripley Atkinson, MLA's Market Information Analyst. Before we do get into the projections, I'll get both Stephen and Ripley to give a bit of a background in their role in MLA. So Stephen, over to you.
Thanks, Brendan, for the introduction. My name's Steve Bignell, the Market Information Manager at MLA. I am from a Merino, Dorper, Thoroughbred and cropping operation in Cochenut, Western Australia. And at MLA, as the Market Information Manager, my team look after all the supply and pricing insights. Our contact details are there in case anyone wants to follow up afterwards for any supply related questions. Thanks, Brendan.
Ripley?
Yeah, good morning, everyone. My name's Ripley Atkinson. I'm originally from a beef, merino and summer and winter cropping operation, Northwest New South Wales at Tamworth. My role is to manage the development and delivery of the beef and sheep projections, respectively 3 and 4 times a year. The development and the delivery of the State of the Industries report, which we expect to deliver to industry at the end of September in 2022, as well as the MLA, AWR sheep meat and wool survey and general day-to-day analysis of the supply and pricing within the Australian red meat livestock markets.
Thanks, guys. We have provided contact details in the slides today, so should you have any market information questions relating to supply and domestic pricing, please don't hesitate to reach out and make contact. Before we start, I just want to cover a few housekeeping points regarding today's presentation. All participants will be on mute throughout the presentation. There will be 20 minutes for questions at the end of the presentation, so feel free to enter your questions at any time throughout. Please enter any questions you have in the Q&A function located at the top right hand of your screen. We will endeavour to get all questions, but may not be able to. So any questions we don't get to during this webinar, we will take on notice. Please note that this webinar is being recorded. A copy of the recording will be uploaded onto the MLA website, and we can share that with today's participants. The full projections document has been released on Tuesday on MLA's website under the Trends and Analysis page. They'll also be circulated in tomorrow's edition of MLA's weekly email newsletter, The Weekly. At the end of the webinar, you will be prompted to fill out a feedback survey. Please complete this survey as it will assist the market information team to improve their offerings and the relevancy of their content to meet your needs. We will now launch into the substantive content for today's and discuss the projections for 2022. So Ripley, I'll start with you. What are the key takeaways of this release?
Yeah, Brendan, thank you. The three key takeaways and the three pillars of what the first report for 2022 deliver is the herd growing by 1.1 million head to 27.2 million head. And on the back of that, due to the seasonal conditions across the country, the herd rebuild will enter two paces from the southern systems, New South Wales and Victoria, particularly in a more mature stage of that rebuild, whereas Queensland and the north are a couple of steps behind. Secondly, on the back of the growth in the herd or the rebuild in its numbers, we see slaughter rising by 11% to 6.7 million head. And following from that, As that rebuild, particularly in the north, continues to develop and mature, we expect production to reach record volumes of 2.448 million tonnes in 2024.
You mentioned the rebuild would be a two-paced nature. Why is that?
Yeah, with the rebuild in 2022, what we're seeing, it's really driven by the seasonal conditions, and that's to do, you know, with New South Wales and Victoria entering their third successive year of above average favourable seasonal conditions, whereas Queensland hasn't experienced that. The rain that it has had, you know, between 2020 and now has, you know, been average to below average, and the impact that's had on producers' attitudes and sentiment towards rebuilding numbers hasn't been, you know, as mature, obviously, because they haven't had grass available like the southern states have. You know, I think looking at the yarding volumes for 2021 for New South Wales and Victoria really paint that picture around producers' rebuilding attitudes. You know, Victoria's cattle yardings year on year fell 29% in 2021, or by 109,000 head. New South Wales, similar situation, fell by 9% or 57,000 head. And I think those statistics paint a bit of a picture or provide that insight in, you know, to how producers want to retain stock and you know, their attitudes about rebuilding numbers. You know, the northern pastoral systems, when we talk about the rebuilding up there and the increase in production I just discussed, will really require this wet season of 22 to end strongly. You know, we know January has been a good month for it, but we want to see that continuing and rains to be above average for the northern systems. And then obviously also in 2023, we'd like to see another good wet season for the rebuild in the north to really strengthen and develop and mature like we've seen in the southern states.
Steve, we've covered the regional herd dynamics. Moving to the national perspective, what is happening with cattle numbers nationally?
So nationally, we have the herd in 2022 going up 4.2% or 1.1 million head to finish at 27.2 million head. This is a slight reduction on where we had it in our 2021 projections. In 2021, we had the herd sitting at 27.8 million head. Now, that revision that we've conducted was based on tied to what Ripley was talking about. So with the with the conception and fertility impacts of the drought still affecting the northern production systems, we've revised that down. And as a result, we've revised down just some of the strength of the rebuild. But if I look ahead to 2024, the herd will reach 28.25 million head, which will be the highest it's been since 2014 and 8% on current levels. If we go through the years, in 2022, we're rising by 4.2%. In 2023, we're rising by 2.7%. And in 2024, when we hit that 28.25, that'll be a rise of 1.2%. So we've really seen a tapering off shape to that graph that you can see on your screen now. And what that that includes, that shows that the herd rebuild will mature. But what it also accounts for is the turn of seasons. When we look out to 2024, that's 3 years away. And so what that tapering shape shows is that we may get a turn of weather events in 2023 or 2024.
So of course, the critical factor in determining the national herd size is the weather. So the forecast for 22, how's that shaping?
So there's a few factors. Currently, none of Australia has declared a technical drought on BOM data, though when we know that that's not necessarily the case. We know in Queensland, while they may have had average rainfall in 2020 and 2021, those rains, when they came or the amounts that they came in, weren't enough to necessarily exit the drought that we experienced up until 2019. So they're not. So the pasture growth isn't really there. While they might not technically be in a rebuild, so there's that's a huge factor, and it means going forward we will shift some of our focus away from necessarily direct rainfall events and towards what's happening in pasture cover. We do know that areas like the Barkly and the Gulf, some of those areas, there is still an ability for capacity to increase and for pasture growth to improve. But if we look at the current event this week, we know some areas have had over 600 millimetres of rain, especially through the Kimberley and that top end. And that shows just the strength of the La Nina we're in. We are in the second La Nina. 2020 and 2021, that summer wet period, was a La Nina, though it wasn't as strong as this current one. So we hopeful, and looking at that BOM forecast there, which has the next 3 months, we expect that La Nina to finish strong. We expect, BOM expect that 80% of Queensland will get above average, above medium rainfall in the next 3 months. And that really underpins a strong start to 2022. In the southern areas, you can see there in the southern part of that map, they are generally winter rainfall areas. So the average rainfall over the next 3 months isn't so imperative. So what that map shows on screen is a really strong start for 2022. The piece I would touch on is, should 2022 not turn out as we expect and as favourable as we expect, I can rest assured that the season won't be as bad as we saw in 2018 or 2019 because of the good seasons that we've had. The good outlook for the next 3 months means that there will be water in dams, soil moisture, grass on the ground and grain. So there won't be a catastrophic situation that we saw in 2019, at least in 2022, 2023. The last part of this I'll touch on, Brendan, is looking ahead. We haven't had BOM have only looked out to April. They haven't looked past that. And so we don't know if we'll be sitting in a neutral phase, La Nina or El Nino, in the 2022-2023 wet season. Having said that, we do know statistically it is difficult or rare for three successive La Ninas to occur. It did happen in the 70s and the 90s. So statistically, while we may not be in a La Nina in the 2022-2023 wet period, we will be looking for the strength of that wet season, and we do expect it still to be somewhat strong.
Good. 20 and 21 were wet in southern Australia, which resulted in record grain harvests. On the back of two record grain harvests, what is the outlook for the feedlot sector as we go through into 2022, Steve, following on from there?
There's probably two parts to this question. It is just a bit of a year in review for what happened in 2021 and then looking at 2022. In 2021, the feedlot sector provided such continuity supply. Slaughter hit the lowest levels in 35 years at 6 million head, though it was really hard to source cattle. Though encouragingly, the feedlot sector sourced 2.85 million head. They entered the system and they really provided this continuity of supply in a period of restricted supply. As a result, we saw 50% of beef production from Australia at one part in the year hit 50%, and even 50% of domestically consumed beef. So in that, we saw some trends. We saw a lot of cattle fed for longer and to heavier weights because it was more cost effective to add kilos rather than for feedlotters to enter the market and source cattle again. And that's a trend that was driven by price, but we expect that to continue into 2022. The piece that we also saw was, the supermarket and Wagyu type cattle were fed for longer, and that those programs definitely became more pronounced. So we look at going into 2022, we expect the feedlot sector to continue to strengthen and to continue to be an integral part of the industry like it has. Some real highlights, it's nearly doubled sort of the number of cattle on feed since 2008. In the last quarter, September quarter of 2021, it was the 15th consecutive quarter of over a million cattle on feed. There were 1.1 million cattle on feed. But if we look really at where we see it going, we look at the capacity. And at the moment, the capacity of the lot fed sector is sitting at 1.4 million head with a utilisation of about 77%. We know that there are projects in the pipeline and we expect these to come online, only boosting that feedlot sector capacity. The other piece in it that we're seeing is there's probably been a change in producer mindset to, on the male side, sell off younger males into the feeder system rather than feeding them out on grass to processor rates, and that's something that we expect to continue, and it is a structural piece. We do expect the number of grain-fed cattle turned off to be the same in 2022. However, we expect the proportion of grain-fed beef to fall, given we expect the grass-fed percentage to turn off to increase as the rebuild matures, and we see a few more females and grass-fed animals hit the system. Last thing I'd just say, is the availability of grain. You did touch on it. So we did have two bumper harvests in Australia. That means there is an abundance of grain. Though one thing I would caveat is that some global factors have meant that the grain price isn't as low as we would expect domestically, given the abundance of it, be it the US drought or some of the geopolitical things going on in the Caucasus and Black Sea regions. Cheers, Brendan.
Ripley, Steve mentioned slaughter from a grain fed perspective. Building on that, Ripley, what can we expect from national slaughter figures in 2022 and beyond?
Yeah, thanks, Brendan. You know, looking at 2022, a rise of 700,000 head or 11% growth in slaughter numbers, and that's on the back of the lowest slaughter volume, which Steve mentioned, in 35 years. You know, moving forwards out to 2024, we're expecting that number to rise to 7.85 million head. That's growth of 31% on our 2021 figures. That may seem significant, but when you consider such a low base that we were starting from, firstly, and secondly, the fact that 7.85 will still be below the 10-year average for national slaughter volumes, it does put it into a little bit of perspective, the movement upwards that we're seeing, you know, over the next 3 years in relation to where we were last year and where we're looking forwards. And on the back of that, from a production perspective, you look at, you know, calves that were born in spring of 2020, autumn 2021, and certainly, you know, spring of 2021 moving forwards into 2023, we're expecting supply to increase in the second half of 2022. You know, breeding females or calves that become breeding females have had, you know, born throughout those years of good successive seasons, have grown up and developed their reproductive organs and their reproductive systems on favourable growing conditions. They have access to positive, you know, or really favourable pasture growth, quality and, you know, amount, which will promote branding rates into the future, obviously. And on the back of that herd rebuild and growth that we see over the next 3 years, that's supporting the 31% increase out to 2024 that we expect to see in slaughter volumes, which will, you know, which will bode really well for the export market.
We know slaughter is one factor that determines the size of our beef production. The other factor is carcass weights. Steve, can you explain what you expect to happen with carcass weights over the next 2 to 3 years?
Yeah, sure, Brendan. So what we have, we've got carcass weights this year being at 311 kilos a head, which is a rise of 28 kilos since 2019, but on a year-on-year basis, it is 2 kilos from 309 this year. What we have been seeing, there's a few factors driving the increase in carcass weights, which is the yellow line on that graph, and you'll see that it is trending ever upwards. Those factors that are driving the ever increasing sort of gradient are improvements in management style, improvements in genetics, and the increasing prevalence of the lot fed sector. Though if we look at the seasonality, we've had a few impacts on what's happening to carcass weight. So with carcass weight, the high prices, as we touched on in the lot feeding discussion earlier, was there is high prices, which is incentivizing producers and feedlotters to add additional kilos to their animals. It makes economic sense. So that's one of the reasons that we're seeing these record prices. What we do see is we expect going into 2023 and 2024 for carcass weights to still stay at around that 311 range. So going to 310.2 next year and 311.9 in 2024, so another record. We expect that plateau to occur if prices soften, there won't be the economics incentive to add kilos to animals. And we also expect, as the herd rebuild matures, as we said before as well, there'll be more females being sent to slaughter, and that will impact the carcass weights that we expect to come through the system. one of the key pieces that we have seen in 2021 was that male carcass weights in Queensland in some parts of, in some times during 2021, exceeded 350, which is a new Australian record, but it's not shy, it's a bit shy of where we sort of see the steer weights in the US. But that's where we sort of see the carcass weights. Prices and seasons are really keeping them elevated. The abundance of feed, be it pasture or grain, is also helping to keep those carcass weights elevated. As you can see on that graph, the dip in 2019 was when we were in a drought. So there is a seasonal element and a gradual trend upwards. Cheers, Brendan.
Thanks, Stephen. I suppose with record carcass weights and higher slaughter forecasts, Ripley, what will happen with production?
Yeah, Brendan, in 2022, we expect to see production rise above 2 million tonnes, again to 2.08 million tonnes, you know, on the back of a lower volume last year in relation to slaughter. And then out to 2024, we expect to see production reach a new level, of 2.448 million tonnes, which will be higher than the previous record set during the drought-induced turnoff year of 2019. On the back of that, you know, the rise in overall production will bode well and bode favourably for Australia's, you know, export markets, where we expect to see over a million tonnes of product exported to, you know, around the globe this year to 1.08 million tonnes, which will be very positive for the export markets and delivering Australian beef to international markets. The other thing to think about, true, is with that rise in production overall, we also expect to see the rise in beef export levels reach records in line with the production record in 2024. And that should amount to 1.224 million tonnes, which again, paints a very positive picture moving forward for the export markets, you know, as the supply of processor eligible cattle come on more to the market, you know, from the second half of next year and out to 2024.
Good. Just a reminder to all that on the right-hand side of your screen is the question and answer. So if you've got any questions, you don't have to wait till the presentation is concluded. If something comes to mind, just you can use that, facilitate that Q&A at any time that suits. One prominent topic in your November 21 release was the live export situation. How do we see that playing out in 2022, especially following those discussions of a two-paced rebuild and the wet seasons for the north? Ripley, I mean...
Brendan, we know 2021 was a very challenging year for the export markets. They faced, you know, supply challenges in relation to delivering cattle to market. You know, there was the incentive or the opportunity of the southern markets and the prices on offer. And there was also, you know, that exponential upward pressure that the price placed on the overall market of the live export, you know, which was something that hadn't been dealt with by the industry before. But I think when you look at it more broadly, 771,000 head was what was delivered to international markets in live export cattle last year. We expect that to soften in 2022, but a really important piece of the picture last year that we saw was the Indonesian resilience. Now, exports were down 12%, but when you look at that overall, in, you know, they were facing supply challenges in relation to cattle in the north, and obviously, you know, the pressure price places on both the exporters and importers, you know, and that relationship, 12%, a softening of 12% can be seen as a positive. Looking ahead, we expect export numbers to get to 830,000 head on the back of, you know, obviously the rebuild growth moving forwards, and we expect that number to be higher again in 2024. Now, we know that headwinds, there will be challenges that we expect to see continue in 2022, particularly relating to supply as producers, you know, are sitting in the shadows of the 2023 wet season, and some really, you know, favourable rains occurring this year for them will set them up well to deliver or you know, put calves on the ground next year. That will create some challenges, and we do expect that to continue this year. There were some other aspects, certainly in regards to Vietnam and the boatload of processor eligible cattle they purchased from Brazil. What does remain to be seen, though, whether that continues, if it continues in large numbers, but that's something that we're not aware of at the minute.
Okay, we might bring the focus back on shore. What are we expecting to happen to domestic consumption this year? We've seen and have been challenged by COVID-19 induced challenges across the supply chain. Are supply chain pressures and high prices going to continue this year? That's probably for you, Steve.
Thanks, Brendan. So there is the supply chain issues. I think that's front of mind for everyone. We did see elements of that in January where we saw that the shelves empty. We did know and dealt with, you know, the COVID isolation related impact on processor capacity. Though when we look at the most recent slaughter data, we do expect for that sort of issue to be passed. And when we did the projections, we had that any COVID related impacts to processing were only going to be in quarter one and we would resume to normal by quarter two. I think we're through that. That's what the slaughter data or getting towards the back end of those supply chain problems that we saw early in January. If we do look at domestic consumption, there is the price. There is definitely that price piece that, you know, people are seeing increases in beef price at a retail level. Though when put into perspective, the price has gone up 195% for Ecky, young cattle, since 2019, though the retail price hasn't flown through to the retail price hasn't increased by as much. So really in the middle of that supply chain, we do know that processors are weathering some of that margin or weathering some of that those cattle price increases, but it hasn't flowed through fully to retailers, which is a really encouraging sign for the retail market, and processors are unfortunately having to deal with those sort of tightening margins that are happening there. If we look at some of the ABS inflation data we get in September for the 12 months, September 2020 to 2021, beef prices were up 10.9% and it was contributing a little bit to some inflationary pressures in the food category. Though we moved to December and it was vegetables and beverages that were pushing up the food category in the inflation for the 12 months there. I think as well, there is the freight component to what we're seeing in retail prices. The price of fuel has gone up 30% year on year, and it's the highest at the moment, at least since 2013 and probably before. So there is the freight component, but that's not hurting just red meat. That's hurting, you know, that's a cost that is involved in getting a lot of products to retail. There is also some changes in behavior, and we have that up there on the slide. We have noticed, and ABS figures are showing, that now there has been a real move to online sales. So 1 billion in sales a month is going to food online food category. So that is something that we saw jump in 2020, in March 2020, when we went into the first lockdown, and that has stayed, and that's a structural change that we expect to be there. The other piece that we have got is that we're seeing people are going to the shopping, are shopping less, but buying more with each shop that they do. And then we are also seeing a trend where people have been a little bit slower to return to food services with after each lockdown, as there's been more lockdowns. So we have seen that occur, and there's a few reasons. There's probably COVID concerns around COVID, but there is also in the last 2 years, there has been the development of sort of some real home cooked meals and a take up of home cooking. But encouragingly, it's not all doom and gloom. In the most recent release of ABS data, in the last quarter of 2021, food service spending in Australia did go back above the March 2019 levels. It had for a large part of last year sat below March 2019, but in the last quarter of 2021, food service spending did go above March 2019 levels. So that's a really encouraging thing when we look at what's happening for the food service trend going forward. The other piece I would just touch on regarding price, we have seen a slight dip in beef sales volumes because of price, but encouragingly, because we have had that price growth and because people do see beef as a premium product, the total value of sales actually hasn't shrunk. So that's a really encouraging point, and I can't emphasise that enough.
So it would be fair to say that on the production side of the beef industry for the 2022 outlook, that there are a lot of positives to take away. But after reading the document, I see that you've outlined some of the key macro issues that you expect will impact the industry this year and moving forward. So this is probably directed to both of you. Can you expand on those just a little bit more on those macro issues?
Yeah, Brendan, I'll start with labour. And labour's been an issue in agriculture proceeding even before the pandemic began. What the pandemic has done and the continuation, you know, we're now into the third year of where it's at, it's cast a very long shadow on accessing labour and the availability of labour as a resource to the agricultural industry or the beef industry right across the supply chain. You know, it's impacting at the farmers' level, at the lot fed sector, through to the processing and the transport or the transportation industry. So it's quite a broad ranging and far reaching impact, you know, on the industry, and it's not isolated to just one part. It's a problem that we're seeing everywhere. You know, as a result of that lack of labour, the impact we're seeing, or the potential lack of labour, has the impact to, you know, impact the productivity of the herd. You know, if we don't have labour resources, you know, at such a crucial time at the minute when the national herd's looking to rebuild and Australian producers, exporters and the industry is wanting to meet, you know, the growing demand for Australian beef, having access to labour and supporting that industry is a real challenge. You know, industry following from this has communicated not having access to both skilled and non-skilled labour in the processing sector does have the potential, if this issue continues to remain prominent, to impact processing capacity. And as a result of that, in time, we may have to revise our slaughter figures based on the impact of labour there. But on the positive side, looking at, you know, the Ag Visa and certainly the Pacific Labour Scheme as more long-term solutions to the concerns we're seeing at the minute, are expected to ease some of those issues that we're seeing around, you know, accessing labour right across the supply chain. That's not just isolated to certain parts of the sector, but we do expect that those, you know, that the Ag Visa particularly, and then the Pacific Labour Scheme has been a fantastic resource. And certainly as the economies begin to recover, you know, consumer confidence, air travel begin to significantly expand or increase from the lows we've seen recently, we expect that to certainly have a positive impact moving forwards. It may not be an immediate effect, but gradually certainly get better than where we've seen currently.
Very good.
I'll just touch on a bit of the international freight and shipping stuff, Brennan. But one of the key things when we talk to industry, and it keeps coming up, is the supply chain issues internationally. We know that this sort of kicked off when Chinese ports sort of went into lockdown at the start of 2020, yet there was still international shipping demand elsewhere. And it really hasn't resolved since those Chinese ports are shut down. At the moment, there's a real bottleneck into the east coast of America with shipping into the west coast of America, which is, it's making access to America really difficult. There's a few other reasons that are contributing to the sort of ongoing freight and logistics issues. There was the rationalization of shipping alliances sort of in the last 10 years, and so there's also been sort of the retirement of a few boats. We do know that there are a few cargo boats scheduled to be built, but they won't hit the water until, you know, late 2022, 2023, and probably won't ease the supply chain issues themselves. There's also, at the moment, the really popular big route in the shipping world is that America to China. So there's a lot of traffic going to the US and back to China and so forth, but it makes that really difficult to access a liner, you know, down into Australia. And so that has put some access to freight issues into the supply chain. There's also, following on from that, is the is the access to empties, so empty refrigerated containers that we export our meat out in. There's a real issue because it doesn't make economic sense for shipping companies to send empty containers into Australia that we will then fill with meat and export. There is a real difficulty in accessing these empties refrigerated containers. So there's a whole lot of issues in that supply chain piece, Brendan. You know, the price has gone up 700% on some routes out of Australia for shipping, average around 300-400%. So there's an increase in price, it's become more difficult to source international shipping logistics. So there's a real issue there, and we don't see it easing necessarily as we go into 2022 fully or 2023. There's also some in-country issues. So in America, it's in California, they've enacted some legislation that has meant older trucks that are deemed to have more emissions, that they've sort of been taken off the road. So there's issues in country picking up the product that we're exporting. And we see these issues as a big topic that we'll continue to discuss with industry and work our way out of into 2023. Encouragingly, there will be the return of passenger flights and air freight capacity should increase, though interestingly, the total number of flights in Australia in the last financial year fell by nearly 40%, though air freight exports out only fell by 12% because there were less passengers going. There was the ability to put more product on planes. We are excited that there will be more flights going out of Australia, though by bringing passengers into the mix, that does limit necessarily how much each plane can take out in freight. So that's a big freight. That's the big freight issue in sort of 5 minutes that we see. The other one that we do see is inflation and what will happen to the US, to the Aussie dollar. So we know that with the high prices, if the Aussie dollar can depreciate, it does buy a bit of reprieve for our exporters and processors. We know when the Fed Reserve last week announced that it would increase rates, the Aussie dollar fell into the high 60s for the first time in a long time. So that depreciated currency is good, though Philip Lowe's speech this week indicated that Australian rates may go up, Australian interest rates may go up later this year to fight inflation, which could put some AUD pressures into the supply chain.
Well, talking of the Aussie dollar, that sort of ties the dice with the export market outlook. So Ripley, could you just give us a bit more forecast for that in relation to the export market outlook?
Yeah, so on the back of the improved slaughter volumes we are forecasting for this year, and then following from that the rise in beef exports to 1.08 million tonnes, we expect 2022 to be a stronger year than last year and grow. Obviously exports were down last year 15% overall, but I think the highlight was certainly the emergence of some new markets and the growth and development of South Korea. South Korea rose to take the second largest exporting nation or amount of product only behind Japan last year, and grew 3% overall, or up by 4,000 tonnes. The other key export nations, China, the US and Japan, all fell. But, that growth of South Korea demonstrates, that evolving reputation, consumer taste and appreciation those consumers or those Koreans have for Australian product. They hold Australia's beef in very high regard, particularly around its origin, its safety, the healthiness for its family, or the nutritional value, you could say, as a safe product that they can access is very important to them, and they believe very strongly in the value that Australian beef, or the expectations that Australian beef meets for those consumers. Beef in South Korea is consumed in a wide ranging or in a number of different mediums and parts of consumer sectors, such as the quick service, retail and manufacturing beef, and right through to the primal cuts in Korean style barbecues. And I just think to highlight the, even in the face of, supply chain challenges and domestically prices rising exponentially in the livestock markets, the demand from South Korea still remained very strong. You look outside of that established market and go to the Philippines, for example, it grew by 26% or 5,500 tons. Vietnam, at the expense of the live export industry, its boxed beef imports from Australia grew 18%. So, you know, while some of those key markets didn't perform as well, you know, the emergence of some of the other markets, such as the Philippines, you know, Vietnam as well, and the growth of South Korea, demonstrates, you know, Australia's position in delivering product to a wide range of markets. There's no concentration on specifics per se. You know, there's other markets opening up, and certainly the positive is seeing that other nations want to consume more and purchase more of our product. Looking outside of that, the emergence of Indonesia is certainly a very significant one, you know, to take a look at. Between 2022 and 2026, the compound annual growth rate for beef sales value is expected to improve year on year by 11.6%. Now, the second part to that is beef consumption is expected to grow in the same 4 years by 2.9%. There's two parts to those statistics. Firstly, the growth of beef sales by 11.6% year on year would point towards a consumer that wants to purchase a premium product, which ties in nicely with, you know, the Australian model of producing premium beef or our production systems. Secondly, 9% doesn't seem like a lot, you know, in terms of beef consumption growth. But when you look at it, Indonesia is the fourth most populous country in the world, and that 2.9% in consumption growth accounts for nearly double the entire New Zealand population. And that's occurring year on year. So, you know, you look at that as a market of opportunity and emergence, and then you look at the positivity out of South Korea and some other markets. Looking ahead with, you know, the improved slaughter volumes, there's definitely some really positive things to take away and certainly look forward to for the export markets moving ahead.
Yeah, good content, Ripley. In 2021, since you adopted, this is to you, Steve, since you adopted the industry analyst ECCE forecast, this development has been quite well received by industry. So how do others see the market playing out for the first half of 2022?
Sorry, I was on mute. You'd think after Sorry, 2 years. So we adopted this in 2021, and it has been well received. So MLA don't do price projections ourselves, but we go out to six really well-respected industry analysts. We go out to Rabo, ABARES, Thomas Elder Markets, Mercado, NAB, and Auctions Plus, and we go out to them, ask them where they see the ECCE sitting in 6 months' time, so the end of the 2022 financial year, and their upper and lower parameters. So when we ran that, for these projections, they do have the ECCE sitting at 998 cents per kilo carcass weight, but they have the upper limit sitting at 1,059 and the low limit at 921. So what people will look at this and think, geez, that's an 11% at the medium level there. That's an 11% fall on current prices. But there's a bit of context to that. And what I'd say to that is, The long-term average, the 10-year average of the ECCE is 547 cents per kilo. So at 998, that is still 82% higher than the 10-year average, and only 2021 prices would be higher. So for producers out there is still strength in the ECCE market. That's what the analysts are sort of suggesting. The reason for any dips would be as the rebuild matures, there'll be more greater supply of animals, and there might be a little bit less restocker demand as the rebuild matures. But encouragingly, these are still record prices in a historical context. So it's a really, really positive sentiment still for producers. Still quite high for processors, but really encouraging for producers.
Yeah, right. Thanks, Steve. Thanks for that. So that's the detail of our presentation here today. So thanks, Stephen Ripley. There's a fair bit of content there for people to digest. But as we said earlier, it's been recorded and it's available on MLA website. So you can go through the content and the detail that's been in that webinar this morning. And we've got a few questions that are starting to come in. the China-Australia relationship and the impact on industry. There's been one or two comments come in about that. So Stephen, firstly to you, and then Ripley might like to add. I mean, it is a topical subject.
I think there's a few points to this. I think you'd never want to diminish China as a market. It does take a lot of the premium product. It is a really valuable market. Though an encouraging thing is that Australia doesn't have a concentration risk with China. Some of our competitors, you know, Argentina are sending north of 70, 75% of their product to China. With Australia, up until African swine fever, we were sending under 20%. It did go up for 2019. But if we look at the moment, last year it still took 17%. So it's still a strong, it's still the fourth biggest market. It's still an important market, but we've got some really strong trading relationships with other markets, and we don't have that concentration risk that some of our other competitors do. One thing I would say is the African swine fever issue and the demand in China is helping push up prices globally. So even if there are issues accessing China, the prices are elevated and we can access other markets. So that's what to Dave's question, that I would say it is considered. China is an important market, but we do have a diversified range of other markets that are, you know, Australia can meet. And also on that, we did have exports down in 2021. That wasn't demand driven, that was supply driven. And we will, even with an 11% increase in slaughter and projection and production and exports up, we still will have some level of supply constraints somewhat this year.
Yeah, thanks, Steve. Ripley, anything to add there?
No, I don't think so, Brandon. I think Stephen's covered it.
One question we also have is, will the beef price have an impact on consumption of beef with customers moving to chicken and pork?
So we do have some data on that. It is in the projections. We do have that lamb fell a little bit in the last quarter as well for pricing issues, and there was a slight uptick in pork and chicken. Though in the encouraging piece is I mean, we had total production and slaughtering down last year, which is an element, but we do expect, and we are seeing with the data that the total value of what people are buying in retail shelves has gone up, and we are an export focused market. So we do export well over 60% of products, you know, some years, you know, over 70 often, 71-72%. So the retail market will continue to be the biggest market and an important market, but we do have those export channels.
Good. Another question's come in. With cost pressures in the supply chain and the possibility of ongoing high cattle prices, do you believe there is room for retail and indeed export prices to increase further, or do you feel there will be resistance? Ripley.
Yeah, I think that's an interesting one to look at. And Steve mentioned it really well, I felt, was, you know, even in the face of the growth of, you know, beef prices at a livestock level, moving into that retail space, yes, we have seen an increase. Everyone knows that, purchase beef at the supermarkets. It hasn't been as exponential and as significant. The potential, you know, for those prices or consumers or exporters to, you know, take that increase in is probably yet to be seen. When you look at the livestock market and the way it's moved, recently certainly stabilized, but it's come back a little bit. And in regards to beef prices, where they then move forwards from that, we're still seeing the appetite from consumers to take on that product. You know, we know that consumers are entering the supermarket to purchase fresh meat less, but they're spending more money, which tells us still that in the face of this increase in price, they're not shying away from purchasing more product, which at present times, that data is quite recent, you know, second half of last year, that's still providing some significant positivity for the attitudes of consumers to take that price on. You know, they're not entering the supermarket as much, but we know they're still prepared to pay extra. and spend more money on sourcing, you know, Australian beef in the supermarkets.
I'd just add as well, Brendan, we exactly what Ripley has said there today. I think another element we expect or we are seeing is we have seen those indicators that are focused towards processors, your medium cow, your heavy steer. They have come off a little bit last year. And at the moment, we are seeing these indicators where you've got the ones that look at sort of longer term producer confidence, which is the EHI, which has still stayed elevated. And then we look at the processor focused indicators, and they have dropped a little bit. Slightly, but I think a key part is exactly what Rip said, is that the value is going up in terms of what people are spending, and that's the key point that we're driving home, is that people are spending more.
Okay, very good. I'm just looking through these questions now coming through. So I just like, while we're just waiting, there's just a few more questions to come through about the price pressures. I think that's been answered by you guys. Thanks very much. So I might just hand over now to Ripley, just because we just want to touch briefly on sheep projections and what's happening there. Ripley, if we can just have a quick overview there.
Yeah. Sheep projections will be a similar layout in a fortnight's time to this week. We expect to release sheep projections, first document of the year, on February the 15th. And then we will conduct a webinar in a similar format to this one, discussing similar issues, both domestically, globally, and the production fundamentals of the national flock, on Friday the 18th of February at 11 a.m. Australian Eastern Daylight Time. You'll be able to register for that via the weekly, which is the MLA's e-newsletter, comes out every Friday. And there will be two banners on the website, one on the way on the main website page when you're on mla.com.au, and the second one will be on the market reports page, where you're able to access the sheep and lamb and cattle physical report or sale yard reports, the indicators, you know, national slaughter figures, OTH reports, etc. Those two banners and the weekly will be the best place for you guys to jump on and register for that webinar, and we look forward to obviously delivering that to industry as well, and having you guys along for the webinar.
Brendan, I will just jump in. There's two questions that have come through. Yep. From Pat Hutchinson, the question is, I would suggest that the ag visas won't have a positive impact on labour supply. One thing, we talked at this with industry at length, Pat, and we do see it as a really crucial issue that could limit supply, but limit production, though we do know that there is the ability to sort of take up a few more shifts if need be. And one thing, the 11% growth seems a lot, though when we go to 6.7 million cattle being slaughtered, that would still be the second lowest, apart from 2021, in 33 years. So we know that, you know, the supply chain was operating in 2020. We know that 11% seems like a big jump, though we know that the supply chain has the ability to take that on. That there was processing above 9 million if we just go back a few years. So we know the supply chain has the ability to take on that 6.7 million and that 11% increase. We do know that from where hysteric figures have been. So we do know that it is a big jump, and we do know and believe that the processing businesses are really dynamic and agile and will be able to address that issue. We do agree that labour will be an issue, and we also, so we do have factored that in. The other one I was just going to touch on was Rod Fowler. Will the export challenges with freight costs and logistics mean we could see lower exports this year? We expect slaughter to increase, Rod, and then given how much we export, we will be able to get that product out of the country. There will be issues. There are scheduling issues. There are cost issues, but we will be able to get that product out of the country.
There's one other here there, Ripley. There's what is the state-based herd breakdown? So could you answer that question in relation to the state herd breakdown?
Yeah, Brendan, just in relation to that question, I actually can't see who it was from, but The information that we receive regarding that, we will have access to soon, and we will be able to publish those distribution maps that we refer to them as on the website. But we actually don't have that information with us within our system at the minute. So it's something that we're looking forward to seeing, and certainly, you know, in regards to your point about the 8% of the national herd in the territory, you know, those sort of trends and changes is something we're keen to monitor a little bit more, certainly at that level, and certainly in the future, looking closer, but it's something that we don't have access to currently.
I've got Angie's question as well, Brendan. Yeah. Are we able to comment on the availability of live chips into Southeast Asia? Is there likely to be sufficient chips? So there definitely is, you know, if we look at 750,000, that was far less than the million that we did just 2 years back. So there is definitely the capacity within the ships existing ships to take those many, to take those animals. With regards to new live export boats being processed, we can take that question offline, but we do know that the existing capabilities within the live export shipping supply chains do exist once the rebuild kicks in.
Thanks, Steve. Well, we're coming to the end of our time, so before we do finish up this webinar for the 2022 projections, I'd like to thank all those who took time to attend, to Stephen and Ripley. A great amount of content to decipher over the coming days and weeks, and I'm sure that people will avail themselves to the MLA website to sort of review what we've gone through this morning, because as I said, there's a fair degree of content there that has to be taken on board. So Stephen, I'll just hand over to you now as we're coming to the close of the presentation here this morning.
Yeah, so that brings an end to the projections webinar this for the cattle. As Ripley has already outlined, we are running one for the sheep projections, which will be released in 2 weeks' time. Similar, this will happen on the Friday, 2 weeks' time. But I'd just like to thank everyone for their time today, all the participants online and the questions. We tried to get to everyone. I do notice there is one around the wiki. We don't do a wiki projection, but it's something we're looking forward to. But we appreciate all the participants' time. Also really like to thank Brendan and Rip for your contribution today. Going forward, we'd like you guys to provide us feedback with how the webinar has gone as you guys leave. We want to continue to use these webinars to share our insights and our products with you guys. And we also want to tailor the products to ensure that what we're delivering in the projections, the webinars, are meeting your needs, your customers' needs. So we would really appreciate if you guys could provide us your feedback and fill out survey that you'll be asked to fill out when you leave this webinar. As outlined by Brendan at the start of the webinar, a recording will be made available shortly to all participants. A PDF of this slide deck can be made available to participants on request. And if your question wasn't answered today, we tried to get through all of them. We had well over 20. Please do touch base with us and discuss your questions further offline. Don't hesitate to contact us. Our details are there on the slide now. We look at all supply side things from feedlot through to the feedlot industry through to what's happening in the co-product pricing. So do hit us up if you have any supply or pricing questions from a domestic perspective. And that on 11:59, Brendan, brings us to the end of our webinar. And we'd like to thank everyone and hope everyone has a great day from the MLA Market Information team.
Thank you all. Bye for now.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.